Luke chapter 14, we shall read from verse 25 to 35. Luke chapter 14, from 25. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower." I know many of you are building houses, not towers. In those days, towers were very important. "Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it?" Verse 29, "For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he's able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000. If he's not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Father, we know that you've given us ears, spiritual and physical, and you are going to give us understanding as we listen to your word being expounded in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, how many of you were in Kuwait, like Mom Jackie was asking, in 1991, during the Gulf War? Oh, so many of them. I don't have time to give you space for testimony. But thank you for bringing me to Kuwait. Your suffering brought me blessing. Your suffering is what is making them celebrate tomorrow and next. It was costly for you, but it was a blessing for some of us. At that time, we did not know of a place called Kuwait. When we managed to, because there is war, so it's in the news, so we said, let's look at it in the map. It was difficult. When I finally saw it in the map, it became a dot. It was a dot. And somehow, I got a letter for employment for a job in Kuwait. And it was getting near time. I didn't apply for a job anyway. It was getting near time. It's a miraculous way. It was getting near time, so I said, let me look. Then when I looked at the Kuwait, I said, when we are coming with the plane, we might fall into the sea. I didn't know I would see a beautiful land like this. You know, so the message today is counting the costs. It costs for you to celebrate, and it's a time for us to remember this as we celebrate with the people in Kuwait. It cost Jesus to give us freedom, you know, and that is what we want to see. I know many of us are going through a lot of troubles, and we think that is the end of it. Many questions are asked in this passage in our response to an open invitation, because before this, they were talking of the kingdom. There were parties. Jesus opened banquet and invited people. He was giving a taste of what heaven was going to be like. And in the process, he brought in some things that we have to think about. He talked about salvation. He talked about being a disciple. He talked about having eternal life, entering God's kingdom, and eating bread in God's kingdom. You know, following Jesus. We want to get a clearer picture of the cost of discipleship. In the first verse We read in verse, large crowds were traveling with Jesus. Large crowds. Large crowds always follow good things. Jesus was turning water to wine. He was multiplying bread and fish. There will be nothing lacking. And the many hungry people have somewhere to eat. So there was a reason for a large crowd. Some were following because they loved Jesus. Others were following more for the company. You know, for where there are many, there will be more. People like to go to where there are crowds. Some of us, we celebrate, we just want to see the crowd. Tomorrow we just come out. Whether there is traffic or no traffic, we will be there. And we just want to see what is happening. We want to see the celebration. We don't think of the liberation of Kuwait. We just want to be part of the celebration. And that is what happens. It is usually a mixed multitude. Some are really for the liberation. Some are really, just like when the Israelites were leaving Egypt. Some Egyptians sneaked in. Other people followed. It was a mixed multitude. And, you know, I wrote something here about what the crowd thought it would be like. If any man come to me and be my disciple, he shall have wealth and honor in abundance. And actually, that is what makes many of us become Christians. We want to have abundance. No more sorrow, no more suffering, but that is for heaven, please. And they just believe that Jesus will say, just leave me alone. I'm going to pour out wealth on him. You know? And so we become Christians. And after becoming Christians, God, you have a problem with your boss. You are praying, it is not working. Jesus tells them something quite contrary. What does following Jesus involve? What Jesus said there in verse 26 is different from what we think of. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. This verse has caused great despair and confusion over the centuries. How can you tell me to hate people? But what does it mean? It does not demand blind, raging hatred of one's family. If it is coming from Jesus, it can never be that way. Because God commands us to love our neighbors as ourselves. It's just the person, you know, God has given various people, including me, the way I express my things may be different from the way Mom Jackie expresses. Although we are trying to blend to one now. I'm trying to understand the way Filipinos worship. I was thinking of it the other day. Sorry, this is the way I give. I'm Nigerian, please. I was thinking of it the other day. I said the Filipinos are vocally loud. The Nigerians are instrumentally loud. If you give them a drum, they will bust that drum. But somehow, every person is loud, even the pretending British. I know some of you are here. You know, but we love ourselves. To love one person, you know, Luke is different from Matthew. If you look at Matthew's interpretation of this, you will see that it's different. Luke uses word for word translation. Luke is a doctor. It's like me. We take the symptoms and we have to take them as the patient says them. No change. And we write it down. And that was the way Luke was interpreting this, in his own way of putting what the Lord was revealing to him. He used a word for word translation. Matthew used a thought for thought translation. Matthew, these philosophers, you know, they think thought. No, they think it. And actually, it becomes clearer. Doctors become too strict sometimes. You want them to explain, they give you another big word. Say, what is the condition of my symptom? Say, well, it's well aggravated by some myalgic problems. And you get more confused. And there is no help. Matthew gave a thought for thought, revealing that Jesus demanded for his followers to love and obey him more than anyone else, even their own families. It was a question of relative love. Would you love more, your family or Jesus? The one Luke gave was actually frightening, but that is the way of understanding it and this way of expression. But what is being told here is for us to take priority for Jesus over our families. And this should never be overlooked. Jesus is number one. There is no need for serious and that, you know, when you think of it, that you have to love Jesus more. Before you come to Christ, you have to think first. There has to be a sober reflection before you make the commitment. You have to make, you know, it was a problem in those days. Let me not go into details because we still have to finish this day. You know, Jesus does not solicit for hasty emotional decision. You know, it doesn't. He urges those who will follow him to think seriously and count the cost. Perseverance will only result. You will keep following if you make a proper commitment. If you don't make a proper commitment, when you start facing all these troubles, you will run out. But if you understand it properly, you will be able to follow, you know, and be the salt of the earth. Remember that Abraham parted with his country. I'm sure you still remember. That man must have been born in Saudi around Iraq. And he went to another place. Moses was in Pharaoh's court, the child of a king. But he went to some kind of bush and met some burning bush, the heat and the desert and the trouble. What is involved in becoming a Christian? Jesus does not encourage an unthinking, impulsive leap of faith in discipleship. Although I ran out from the church, I was around the middle of the church. They said, hell is waiting for you. I said, I don't want hell. I ran out. I said, I'm born again. And after 2 months, I deborned again. I went out of Christ. Then after another 6 months, I came back. Because the first one was false, fake, emotional, fright, not real. Anyway, if you did that at the beginning, you can do like me and come back again. That's why I love this door that is open for us to always try and come back. We should reflect on what the act of commitment involves. Now, in the passage we read, three conditions are described. Those are the ones I want us to reflect on as we go. The three conditions described in the past, the first one is hating one's family. The second one is bearing the cross and following Jesus. The third one is renouncing possessions. That one is difficult. Possessions. Hating one's family, as I've explained before, is putting Jesus above all relationships. Every good man loves his relations, but our comfort and satisfaction in them must be lost and swallowed up in our love for Jesus. We must love Jesus above our families. Not that you should hate your families, but let the love of Jesus take preference. We must always give Christ the preference. It is better to lose our societies than his favor. I want the favor of Jesus. I want the favor of Jesus. If you know the favor of Jesus, you will know what things you will miss if you put him last. Now, bearing the cross and following Jesus. That one is in verse 27. Anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. What is cross? Are we going to take the cross from Jesus and carry it again? Cross was something that Jesus carried. It has a lot of different meanings. You know, it may be having an ill name because you're a Christian. You know, we mocked, before I became a Christian, we mocked Christians. We said, look at them, they're always looking depressed. And we speak it out to them, let them feel bad, and we'll be excited. We discuss with our friend, I just dealt with that Christian. And some of them were so weak, they ran out of Christianity. God forgive me. But the thing is that some names come as a Christian. You continue to strive for the Lord and bear those things. Heal them. It may be disgrace. You may come across disgrace for following Christ. You know, you pray for somebody to be well. The person gets well and gets sick again. You know, you do it in the hospital and you come back, they come to you. Come and pray again. There was a time Jesus was hanging on the cross. Before then, they were taking him there. They slapped him. He said, who slapped you? Where did it come from, right or left? And, you know, and we face smaller things than that. And we think it is bad. One thing is that we fetch encouragement from Jesus and live in hope that he will recompense us, remove the shame, remove the heel name, and make us better. If I tell people now to give testimonies of where they've come from, there'll be many. Of problems you faced, of difficulties you faced. And the sweetest one I know is this, where is this Nathan? Oh, he's at the back. Should be in front. No, I can't call him from the back. Time is gone. Yeah. Too bad. But now he's excited. He played the drum last week in sickness. He played the drum this week with joy. Yeah. This small boy, I don't know when he accepted Christ. If he can do it, then all of us can go carry our cross and continue to serve Jesus. Amen. There is hope. There is recovery. Then you can celebrate at the end. Like today. I don't know how we celebrate for Nathan. Anyway, let the parents do that. Renouncing possessions is in verse 33. You know, sometimes we hold to what we think is our own. But the biggest example I have is money. To give offering to God, tithe. Especially when your salary, you know, you pray for increase in salary. And the salary suddenly increases. And you have to pay 10% of that for tithe. And you bring it out to put in the envelope. So all this will go to the church. It's the pastor that is taking it. And all these people working in the church, they are very lazy. Oh, and after that, then you start calculating your expenses for the month. Then you just pick 20K the back and put in your pocket. Don't worry. If I didn't do it, I wouldn't be able to give the example. You know, they are looking at me, it's the pastor preaching. So no trouble. It didn't go through that. Now it's easy for me. I've gone through phases. I don't only have to give. I have to give the envelope to my wife to prove that I'm giving. So don't worry, you will pass through that phase. That's why I love this Christ. He doesn't condemn us. He makes us to grow stage by stage. He allows us to walk on the water. Even when we are drowning, he will pick us up again. That is Christ. That is Christ. Never you get discouraged. Don't worry. If you are not tithing now, after this message, if not next week, in 2 years' time, you will start tithing. I have seen the blessings of that. Now, let me not, it's time. Let's reflect. At least we've got something. If you didn't get from the call to worship, if you didn't get from the prayer, pastoral prayer, blessings, and just release of worship and liberty, then this must have touched you. What price have you had to pay to follow Christ? How receptive are you to Christ's call to discipleship? Are you ready for all these three things we mentioned? Hating one's family. I mean putting Jesus first, bearing the cross and following Jesus, and renouncing possessions. What have you resolved to do from today? We play our part in building God's kingdom, where we seek his kingdom first. Hunger and thirst for him and refuse to waste our lives. He is our joy and prize. We shall see him face to face in a place with no tears, no shame, no sin, no sorrow, no more fears, and no more pain. We are going through all these costly things for an everlasting life. There is life after this time. We are moving towards that. It cost Jesus so much to set us free and give us a kingdom. It cost so many people so much to set Kuwait free. As we celebrate this season, let us know that it is going to cost us something to be part of the building up of this nation. But much more, following Christ means denying ourselves of some wasteful luxuries to enjoy the many promised blessings. Oh, are we ready to be disciples of Christ? Are we ready to leave certain things and just go for him fully? If that is our desire, then there's a time for celebration.